Hallelujah. 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 Ah, yes. Yabrach. Yisrael, the people of Yah, by his sovereign election, has nothing to do with us and our ability to elect, because we don't do that quite well, Yisrael. But Yah has the ability, according to his sovereign knowledge, to elect according to his purpose. And for that, I am glad today. I'm exceedingly glad for the riches of his blessings that have been showered down to the revelation of Yeshua HaMashiach, that he makes known the power of his Torah. And not only that, but it becomes real each and every day as we meditate, as we ponder what he commands us. And then we see the fruit of that in our own lives. You will know that you are going beyond, moving beyond, extending beyond the laws of your flesh. You began to see the reflection of his awe, the light of Yeshua HaMashiach. And we know that Yeshua, he did all things to please Almighty Yah. And that must be the emphasis of our lives, that we do all things to please Almighty Yahweh. And in doing that, then we will work the works of Almighty Yah. And that is simply believing on him, as Ariah Zachin Yarameyah, as he brought forth that delight unto us on Yom Revi'i, that we must believe on him whom he has sent. That is a powerful statement. Because if we believe on him, Yeshua, then we will do what he commands us to do. For he speaks by the revelation of the mitzvah of Almighty Yahweh. He did not speak of his own accord, but he spoke by the commands, the statutes, the ordinance that were written in him, because he was and is the Torah of life. For whatever Yah speaks, it brings life. Even death brings life. Even death cannot stand against him, because the very word went down into the depths of Sheol, into the depths of darkness, and yet there was no power to corrupt it. So man cannot corrupt the speech of Yah. We cannot corrupt what he has established. In all of our diligence to try to alter, you cannot do it. The body did not see any corruption at all. The skin worms did not even begin to eat on that body, because there was no corruption in him at all, Yisrael. That is why we must rid ourselves, as we were reminded, the pure mind stirred up by way of remembrance, that we should not be a people that defy with a practice to defy the Torah of Yah, that we sin willfully against Almighty Yahweh. You that know what to do, that it is right to do. You that know to do tav and you do it not, then it is a sin. For we know that the Torah is tav, and everything that is written in the book is excellent. For it brings forth the excellent of the power of Yeshua HaMashiach. Why will we sell that for these little fleshly trinkets? Tell me. That baffles me, even as an ignorant man I am. That baffles me. That we will sell the rights of our heritage for what? For what? We sell it for some of the most simplest of things that have no everlasting effects in our lives, do not grant us any pleasure at all. We sell out for nothing. For nothing. We will deny Torah for what? For the moment. And then what does it produce? Death. That's all. And as we sow unto our flesh, we will find ourselves even the more corrupt. Yes. We must stop that, Yisrael. Yeah. It is the power of the God mind that says, to hell with the statutes of the Most High. Yes. I have determined by my own resolve, by my own determination, what is proper, what is right, and what is wrong. And I will challenge any God that tries to promote anything any differently. That's why we, as a nation, a people, it is difficult for us to listen to others. Because once we establish what is right in our minds, although it is wrong, although we are in error, then we tend to hold fast to that. And so when one wants to challenge that and show us what is proper and right, then the power of our God, the tower of our strength, which is weak, begins to rise up. And we began to speak our empty, open minds, whereby there is nothing in there, Yisrayah. The only mind that has substance, it is the mind of Yeshua HaMashiach. And that mind is governed by Torah. It is governed by ordinance and disciplines that brings about an excellent man, an excellent woman, a man of power, a woman of authority, a man of beauty, a woman of tremendous tiferah. And the enemy has seduced us by his mirima, the subtleties, the enticing, the treacherous lies of his speech, to create in our mind, in our leba, what we think he is saying, and he is literally not saying that. Have you ever tried to say something that you could not just get it out right, and you're trying to express something and it did not come out right? I will take it to the other extreme. Have we ever tried to explain something, not exposing the depth of what has been done, so we use alternate words to cover the vision of the sight of others that they cannot perceive? We're guilty of them all. That's why we must understand the power of his iman. I want to begin here. Yas will, I am hoping that I finish this up today in this process. We can never finish this teaching, but this process, we will see how and what Yah does, what he yields unto my ruach that I speak. Because this cannot be taught in a few little segments like this. It must be taught daily. We must be reminded in our gatherings. We must talk about it. We must understand the depths of the wicked one. How he deceives the minds of the masses of the people. He is not just some little weak thing that this religious whore has taught us. You cannot fight a one that is of strength unless you are of strength. And we know that our power, our might comes in the knowledge of the power of Torah. And if we don't have that, then we have no power of resistance. We are no match for him at all. Yeshua was the word, was he not? And the very challenges of hell, he spoke the power of Torah. It is written. It is Hattam. He was a man, as we were reminded. Sure he was. He walked in flesh. It was the power of Torah that kept that flesh subject unto the beauty of Almighty Yahweh. You understand? That is what, and when we, greater is he, the power of the revelation of Yah, that is in us, than he, not only our flesh, but he, the opposition of Yah, that is in the world. It is Hashatan, he is Yah's opposition. And so we began to grow in the delights of Torah. We began to understand the beauty of Torah, the strength, the magnitude, the might of Torah. There's no power of hell that rise up against us. We speak the power of truth, and it must flee. Even when our minds rise up in opposition against Torah, we will bring everything subject unto the will of the Torah. Your thoughts and your purpose rise up against Yah. You will all become subject to the Torah. The enemy has a magnificent plan that he keeps us ignorant, unlearned, without the ability to discern, without prudence, without knowledge, because we simply do not give a damn. We don't care to refresh ourselves in the Torah daily. We don't give a damn. We don't meditate upon the Torah. We don't delight in the Torah because it is not special to us. And so what we tend to do, we become slothful and lazy. And then poverty began to ensue us. We're poor in our ruach. When a man is poor in his ruach, he is poor in his appearance. His look doesn't look healthy. His strength doesn't look healthy. His power does not promote the inner power that is in him. And so because we do not nourish ourselves in our minds, we do not nourish the body of Yeshua HaMashiach, then we fall to the weak and beggary things of the world. We're captivated by the simple beggary things. We delight more in trinkets and folly than we do the imat ha-imat, the truth. His truth is his characteristic revealed unto us. That is truth. But a judge a man, he can tell by his speech what he conveys, what his character consists of. And that's what Yah's trying to get and make known unto us. He's trying to get that through this web of folly and this most dangerous thing, our own hearts, that he must cleanse it before he can get through to the depths of it. And it can only be done by the power of his truth. We'll cleanse by the power of his imath, the dam, the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach. Let me read this verse. I want to establish the truth of his people, us. We're not going to placate. We're not going to stroke us lightly. We're going to speak the truth to Yisrael. We're going to find out where our problem lies. And when we find out that, we will understand why we have so many damn twisted gods. Damn every god. Damn them all. Damn every Baal. I will define it. Just give me a moment, all right? We're going to progress here a little today. So damn them all. I had this most vile thing the other day that saw me. The individual looks at me, well, when you were here, you were a woman. I didn't talk to you nor grin in your face. And there is no way under the Hashem Ma'ams of Yah that I will grin in your face in this wicked world. I didn't speak to you here. I spoke to you in the morning, and that was it. There was no chit-chat, and this most vile, hideous-looking creature looks at me and says, oh, Pastor Roberts, God bless you. Of course, my response in any other fashion, I would say, damn, you're a damn wicked God, and damn you, for you and your God shall be damned. But I did not even exert the energy of Yah to even reply. I turned my head. You go your way. I'm going the way of Almighty Yah. This wicked world cannot challenge the truth. Shaul says, be ye followers of me as I am of Yeshua HaMashiach. That's what the Torah commands us. When a man walks outside of the realm of Yah, if he walks outside of the parameter of the calling of Yah, you will know it. He will not lead his sheep astray. This is our problem. This where it begins here. I want to read quickly here in the book of Hosea. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. I know what it says. I want to read it. Yah says, my people, my nation, my possession, he said, they are dama, they are destroyed. They are brought to naught. They become undone so easily. They don't know how to do. He said, my people, they are destroyed because they believe, they lack, they are without. His people, the word believe is without, no, none. Non-existence. It does not exist. His people. He is not talking about the world. He is talking about his people. They are destroyed. They are doma. They are destroyed. They are brought to nothing. They are brought down. They are destroyed because they lack knowledge. They lack da'at. We lack the ability to discern. We have no skillful perception as to what is of Yah and what is not of Yah. We are an unlearned people. We are not prudent. And we are not wise in the subtleties of HaShatan. He seduced the woman by the power of his mirmah, his words of subtlety and deception, his words to seduce her mind. It's like a man seducing the mind of a woman, or the woman seducing the mind of the man, to bring them into their oasis and they can practice their skills on them. That is why wisdom warned the foolish young man that the spirit of the harlot sits in the casement or in the doorway, and she watches and she sees a silly man. She sees one that is unlearned, that has not the skills of Yah, and she says to him, come into my doctrine. Come into my teaching. Let me show you. Let me teach you. Let me show you my God power. And because he is unlearned, because he is without da'at, he cannot discern this dirty whore. He is allured by her mirmah, her words, and the power of her words. And that is what the power of the gods do to Yisra'iyah. And it begins with one of the most damnable gods of all times. One of the most vilest gods that one can imagine. It is the damn putrefied gods of your belly. It is our own bellies, our own Bethlehem, our minds and our inward being that drives us, instead of the Torah of Yah. Our emotions, our feelings, our likes and our dislikes. We're not driven by the speech of Almighty Yah. His imra, the words of his utterance, do not drive us. So we're destroyed because we lack, we believe, we don't even possess the power of da'at. We don't discern. We cannot differentiate what is of Yah and what is not of Yah. We don't have the ability and the prudence of wisdom, being wise by experience, to understand a matter to its conclusion and to see what the end will be. Even our forefathers had that. Without knowledge and power of truth, that Ima could say to the daughter of the sun, that robe will bring death upon you. It doesn't cause you to flourish. You're going down the wrong roads. They could discern their association. They're no tough for you. They're going to lead you down an errant path. They have the ability to discern. We don't have that ability. That's why we are destroyed. That's why when the Torah is spoken, we bring opposition against it. We oppose the Torah. That's the reason why. He says, because you have ma'as, you have despised, you have refuted, you have rejected, because you have rejected da'at, knowledge, because you do not want it, because you despise it, because you allow your heart to rise up against it, Yah says, I will also ma'as reject you, and you shall not be a Kohan to me. You shall not be a Kohan to me. Do you understand the power of a Kohan? He was the one that taught Torah. He was the one that brought revelation of Torah. He was the one that offered up the offerings unto Yah. We can't even offer up the offering of praise now, can we? We don't even know how to offer up the Torah unto Yah. We see that evident among Yisra'iyah. I don't care where I go. People don't know how to praise Yah. They don't know how to offer up Torah. They're not willing to do it. Why? Because he has no Kohan. Because that was the office of the Kohan, to lead in the order of Yah's offerings and to make sure that one was prepared and ready to bring the offering to offer unto him. So there is no sacrifice of praise today. There's no sacrifice of Torah from the bosom of Yisra'iyah. There is no chorus of Ishirim, songs of delight from our bosom. Yeah. He said, you'll be no more Kohan to me. A Kohan had to be thorough in the Torah. A Kohan had to understand the disciplines of the Torah. He could not walk outside of one parameter of the Torah. Everything in his life was confined by the Torah, and it refined his life to make his life a beautiful life. He said, seeing you have, Yah says, you have shakah, you have forgotten me. You have actually ignored me. You have obliterated me out of your memory. Our thoughts during the daily thoughts never are rendered unto Yah. We don't think about him. We think about the God of our belly that deceives us and carry us forth in the mirmah and our deception, our lies, our shirk. We think we're getting by, but we're not getting by. We don't dress our minds with the garments and the clothing of Yah. Everything that we see naturally, we see it spiritually. That's why we see the people, they don't dress their minds with the Torah of Yah, his beauty. The women today don't cover themselves. The men today, they don't dress in a way that is appropriate before Almighty Yah. They don't. I watched those I saw one that they dressed in a way that was decent and proper. And I saw them dress in a way of such harlotry. The words that Yah uses, keli, that a woman should not put on a garment, keli, that pertains to a man. It is the same, the word keli is the garment, the dress. It's the same word of disease, keli, khali, same word. And so the diseases are dressing the people today. They're clothed with every kind of disease. Their minds are clothed. Because the mothers dress their daughters like little harlots. Because mama acts like a harlot. She dresses like a harlot. So she dressed the daughters like that. And their little minds are diseased minds. They don't know what is proper, what is right. Because mother walked in such damnable hypocrisy. Because she thinks she's holding something. You're not holding nothing but a bag of filthy, fleshly sin. That's it, Yisra'yah. We cannot sin willfully against Yah when we come to the knowledge of the Torah. And because you have rejected Torah, and because we're a nation that has shokhath, we have ignored Yah, we have forgotten Yah, we have actually caused him to be eradicated from our memory. We give him no attention. He said, because you have forgotten the Torah of Yah, your Abba, he said, I will also forget your children. You all hear that? We have forgotten the Torah. And so our children have gone into this damn thing we call God worship. And Baal, these are nothing but demons and powers of hell that rebel against Yah. It was not Yah that spoke to Hava and said, the day you defy me, you will become a god. It was HaShatan. He said, the day that you defy me, you shall surely die. You will have no sensitivity of me. We're dead because sin is what brings death. When sin is finished, it brings forth death. Yah says, when you finish your sin, you're going to die. It's going to bring forth death. Surely you will die. And we have seen the death of the conscience of man. We have seen the death of our children, our sons and our daughters, whereby there is no love for Yah at all, because they are khali, they are diseased, and their minds are diseased, because the ima, the avat, and all those they associate with, their minds are full of diseases and death. You cannot get healing out of something that is death. And HaShatan saw the opening in the gullibleness of this beautiful thing, because she was not attentive unto the Torah that was spoken to us. We, the assembly of Yah, we're not attentive unto the Torah. We attend to every kind of damn trivial thing. We attend to everything that will not progress us in the ways of Yah and the knowledge of Yah, that when men see us, that they will see a mighty man. When Baptist Zion sees, when the women see Baptist Zion, they will see the beauty of beauty. Not just something that is superficial, but the beauty of beauty. They will see that beauty. They will see the strength, the koach, the might, the strength, the power of Yah. Because when the man speaks, his words are volume. They bring life. The tongue of a wise, it brings life. It produces life. The tongue of a fool, the loshon, it produced death. And that word loshon, not only is it the implement of one's mouth and the thing that is shapen, but it's also language as well. I want to bring that home to us. Let me define, show you how the enemy, how that his mirama, his deception, his treachery of loshon, the tongue, to create language, to deceive the mind, and whereby you think you understand and you really don't. I want to define one word that it is so common in the vocabulary of America. We're getting back to the God thing. Damn every God. We will deal with the God thing. But there's a word in our vocabulary. It is called guy, G-U-Y. People use it. They don't know the word can be used as a transitive verb, a verb. It can be used as a noun. They have no idea of the meaning, but yet it is commonplace among our speech. I defy that when someone calls me a guy, because I'm not a guy. I defy that when they call my wife a guy. You will not do that. Well, it's just the way we know. I don't give a damn how you talk. I am not a guy. You call me man. You call me sir. You can even call me dude. But don't call me a guy. I want to define that. And people, they use it as though that it is a friendly gesture. Just like the damn God term. Like it's right. But it's not. I will define this by the College Merriam-Webster Dictionary number 6 edition. This is how it is defined. Hallelujah. Transit verb. Its etymology from Middle English and from Middle French, gura, more at guide. In the archaic sense, guide. Guy as a noun. It tells us probably its originality is from the Dutch words Gabriel. It tells us it is a rope, a chain, a rod attached to something, as an object being hoist or lowered, to brace, steady, to guide it, a cable connecting a suspension bridge with land or either side, or prevent lateral swaying. Etymology, what is used in the sense of a verb, in the sense of a noun. The etymology, the origin of the word, its creation by the linguists. While they created this word, it tells us this. After Guy Fawkes died in 1606, the English conspirator, he conspired to overthrow Parliament. When the word guy is capitalized, a ragged and grotesque effigy, that's what it means, of English conspirator Guy Fawkes, customarily paraded and burned in England on Guy Fawkes Day. An effigy of any person similarly treated, chiefly among the British, among Britons, what is used with the lowercase, as we would say, you guys. That's what people say all the time. You guys, no. A person of grotesque dress and appearance. They look like a pack of jackasses. They're fools. They're double fools. When it used in the transitive verb application, it simply implies to make fun of, ridicule often, with what they call good humor. Person, used in the sense that it has no direct identity of gender, whether you're male or female. It is one thing that you cannot confuse me with a female. Not at all. I'm a man. I don't have a smooth face. My beard is on my face. So I am a man. I'm bringing that forward to show us how the subtlety of darkness and Hashatan. You guys, you bunch of jackasses, you stupid individuals. That is what one is implying when one utilizes that word. And it is so commonplace among the people today. Your babies use it. Everyone uses that word because it is a destructive. There's the power of life and death is in the lashon, in the tongue. And when we're talking about language, you can produce death or life in the language. It is a doctor telling you your diagnosis and telling you he can cure it. It is the language of his tongue. Even though you don't understand, it produces life in you. It is death that when one says, I'm going to blow you away, you understand that language. The Lashon is what creates language. And it is the power of the tongue to deceive and to draw one's mind away from the thing that should be attentive to or attention should be given. So instead of our minds being attentive unto Yah, our minds give attention unto the damn gods and the Baals, the lords, the demons. And that's all the gods are. They are demons, the powers of hell, the demonic force that rebel against Yah. That's why Hashatan said, the day you defy him, the day you said, you speak your own mind, that you do what you desire, you will be a god. A god cannot create one damn thing. He did not create the heavens. He did not create you. Damn of a god, the lords can't create anything at all. Nothing, Yisrayah. And so the gods drove the attention away from Almighty Yah. So everyone has a god today. And they're corrupt. They're wicked. They're dirty. They're vile. And they're unclean. Yah will not even allow his honor and the beauty of his estate to be shared with no one. I want to read that quickly. It says here in the book, hallelujah, in Jeremiah, I want to reintroduce this again, Jeremiah 10 and verse 6. Jeremiah 10, 6, for as much is there is none like you. There is none like Almighty Yah. None like you, O Yah. You are great. You are Gebarah. You're mighty. Your deeds are mighty. There is none like you. You are Gebarah. The things you do, no one can duplicate that. What Yah does, no one can duplicate it. We cannot duplicate a star. We cannot duplicate one seed. He is not relegated down to the status of a damn god. His works are Gebarah. They're mighty. They're powerful. They're beyond the mind to express. Unless you have the mind of Yeshua, you can never understand the Gebarah of Yah. There's none like him. Nobody like him. No one is as creative as Yah. No one can create like the Most High. No one can draw nothing out of nothing and produce what his mind says. No one can. I don't care how we draw on our imagination, our dreams, you don't create one damn thing. You don't create one thing. Nothing at all. And so Yah draws from nothing, out of nothing that we see, and he creates, he bara, he calls life to be asa, to be fashioned according to his words. For his words are powerful. And if we will allow the Torah to fashion the power of his identity in us, we will be a mighty people. We will be a great people. We will be a rich people beyond what this damn world called rich. Bill Gates is not rich, he's a poor man. That's not the riches of Yah. He's a poor man. He has no substance of life. He's a fearful man. He has to have someone guarding him 24/7. That's not rich. He's full of sorrows. The riches of Yah adds no sorrows to Yisrael. We'll be a nation that the kings of the earth would come and inquire of our leaders, what is the standard of this kingdom? It prosper when no other kingdom prosper. He intended to do that here. But because we reject Torah, we reject Yah, we create these damn gods and Baals, then we have no power. We create our own Baal. We create our own lords and our gods. By our superficial, immature emotions. And so we really don't care what Yah says. We show him no love at all. None whatsoever. How do we show him love? By obeying his commandments. Doing what he commands us. He said, there is none like you. You are great and your name is mighty. It is Gebran. Your name is a powerful name. See, that name, God, is not a powerful name. It's a damn delusion that is twisted. It's a damn corrupt title. That's why I will say, damn every God, damn every Baal, damn all the lords, their Christo, their Christes, their Jesuses, all of them, because they all have a different Jesus. There is only one. He is Ikad, he is mighty, and his Torah is for Yisrael and the stranger Alak. It makes no difference. Under the auspicy of this government, of this religious power, they said, you are the diaspora. You gather there, and because we are superior and we have the knowledge of Torah, we gather here. We will teach you. You keep their mind subjugated unto our God, and you will know our God, where your God is corrupt and wicked. You serve a damnable, twisted, effeminate, faggot God, and your little damn twisted, effeminate Christ, or your Christ, is a damn faggot. It makes no difference whether you concur with me. I'm not afraid to say what I say. Hallelujah. Not one bit at all. I am not afraid. I will not apologize. And this is what the world has done. This is what it has done to a people, to malign them and to bring them subject unto the God power. I will thresh it out in this teaching today, whether you buy it or not. So first of all, we know that he is Gebran. There is none like him, none whatsoever. I want to draw your attention to the prayer of Dawid in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 22. Dawid said, therefore, you are Gadol, you're great, you're mighty, O Yah. You're the great sovereign master, 2 Samuel 7:22. He said, for there is none that is iron, there is none like you. I am a man, you're a man, he's a man, he's a man. We are all alike. We all have the same similitude. I don't care whether one is shorter than the other, one is taller. It makes no difference at all. We are of the same like passions. We sin, we fall, we give ourselves over to our own lust. We're seduced so easily. This is a woman, that's a woman, that's a woman. They all have the same similitude. They all have the same demeanor. But Yah says that we said there is none like you. There is no one that is in of the same image as you. There is no one that is of the same mind. There is no one of the same characteristics. There is no one of the same power as you, Almighty Yah. There is none like him. There is no existence of anything that is comparative to Almighty Yahweh. Nothing. No damn God, no Baal, no mighty kingdom like the kingdom of Yah. There is nothing like Yah. There is none. Zilch. He cannot share the same honor as HaShatan, man, because he is not like a man. Hallelujah. He showed us that in the power of Yeshua HaMashiach. There is none like you, neither is there any Abba beside you. There is no mighty one. There is no one that is great in power but Yah. There is no one that has the power to create, to bring down, to destroy, but Almighty Yahweh. He says, according to all that we have heard with our uzen, with our ears, according to everything that we have heard, we have Shemach. When you hear of the beauty of Yah, we should embrace it, Yisrael. We should embrace what Yah speaks to us. It is a great treasure and a treasure trove, and we hide it in our leba, in our minds, in our hearts, that we will not sin against Yah. Because we don't hide it, then we give space unto the wicked one, the god of this world, which is not sown in the tough soil, what is sown among thorns, and it falls by the wayside. It falls by the wayside because you don't give a damn. When a man sows seeds and he has but a small amount, he makes sure that every seed is precisely sown. He is looking for fruit out of the seed. When one thinks that he or she possess great abundance of riches, they don't give a damn. So when the word fall by the wayside, as soon as the trials of life and the temptations, immediately you're seduced and drawn away from Torah, and your mind is given over unto sensual and worldly things. And that which is sown by the thorns, when the cares of this life and the consequences that we endure, it began to choke out the power of the Torah of God, you become unfruitful. But that which is sown in the soil and the riches of the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach, the Torah that is sown in the works of Yah, that we believe on him who he has sent, then it began to bring forth the abundance, 30, 60, and 90 folds of abundance of Yah's increase. And we ought to be bringing forth the abundance, but there is no increase in the God world because it is one of the most seductive, wicked worlds of all. Everyone is trying to establish their own mandate. Isn't that what we are doing? Everyone is right in his own eyes. All the ways of a man, they're right in his own eyes. But the end thereof is death. It is muth. One dies. Your heart dies, your will, your purpose to please Yah. All of that dies, Yisra'yah. So there is none like him. And the only thing that it can express, he said, great is your name. Gibberah is the name of Yah. The only thing that expressed the power of him is his name. He doesn't need a title. Is his name. He doesn't need a title. See, there have been 43 presidents before this one we have today. And we can recall even the names of 10 of them. But yet there is only one that has the name that is great and is powerful. When the kings of the earth and the powers that be, when they hear that name, they tremble and they bow down. Yeah. They don't bow down to the damn gods because they're equal. They're all are gods. They don't bow down to the Baal because they're all a Baal. They don't bow down, Yisra'yah. That's what language, the Loshon. We have to be careful. Our speech, we have to make sure our words are seasoned by the very heart of Yah. That's why there are words that we ought to eradicate from our vocabulary because they don't express Yah. And I will show us that in the teaching to come. Hallelujah. One of the words is divine. That should be that is nothing but a demonic power. It is the same as deity. You all listen the way I talk. Just talk the way I talk. Follow my pattern and eradicate that damn trash out of your mouths. It is all wicked, Yisra'yah. This is the subtlety of Hashata. Oh, Yah know that the day. Did he say that I will surely die? Did he say you couldn't eat from the tree? He give us all things that pertains to life and his Siddiq and Yeshua. He's given us all things. Why do we need to go outside of that? And we are lured by the power of the God. The most powerful God is the God of our belly, the God of our mind. That no God is going to control that. One more verse here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Tehillim and Psalms. Psalms 86 verse 8. David says, among the gods there is none like to you, O Sovereign Yah. Neither are there any works like your works. There's no works like the Ma'aseh of Yah. There is no damn wicked God that is like Yah. Let it be that we are gods. That's what it says, doesn't it? Are we like him? Talk to me, Yisra'yah. We're not like him. There is no God like him. There's no power that is like God. There's no power that is like him. No damn God that is like Almighty Yah. For his name is great. We don't even know the gods that we have served. No one like him. No one has the power, the might, and the beauty of Almighty Yah. We have given ourselves over unto every wicked thing it is. And what we must do is go back and see our forefathers and how they move out of the realm of Yah and whereby their enemies overtook them and the powers that be subdued them and brought them under hard bondage. We are, as a nation of people, we are under hard bondage in this nation and the nations of the earth. You oppress every day. You can't even go out of your house. Your children, you fear for them. You fear for someone snatching them up, robbing you. That's just the truth, whether you buy it or not. You got to bar your houses up there, cities there, whereby they got bars all around their house. You tell me that's not oppression. That is not of Yah. You walk down the street, you're afraid. You don't know who is going to try you and rob you. You don't know that. Neighborhoods that if you go to and if they don't know you're in trouble. And that's a fact. And neighborhoods you go to and they don't know you're going to jail. No different at all. That's not living. That's not the life of Yah. He gave Yisrael the promise. He gave them a beautiful land, Goshen. And they had all that they need. A community to learn how to love Yah and to love each other. He gave his commands to that nation of people. Not to the Egyptians, not to the Philistines. He gave it to them that they will be the pattern and example of the mighty one. Because there were many gods in Mishraim. In Mishraim. There was many gods there. There were many gods of Babel. There are many gods in the earth. Gods many, lords many. But there's only one mighty one. Only one. And because we have not carefully attended to the things of our forefathers, we're all given over unto that same God worship. It says here in the book of Yeshaya, Isaiah 46, verse 9. The word of Yah unto Yisrael, he tells us to remember the former things of old. Yah says, for I am Almighty Yahweh, and there is none else. I am Yah, and there is none like me. He said, you can look all you want to. You're not going to find a damn thing. I am the mighty one, and there is no other one. I am the original one. You're not going to find anyone that is similar to me. You're not going to find someone that has the same power, the same mind that I have. There's none like me. So all of your damn idol worshiping, and that's what they were doing. That's why Yah sent an army to speak to them. They were worshiping their Jesus Christ, their damn pagan Christmas, the folly of their Esther, all of that. They're worshiping their black holidays, their white holidays, all of this vile, filthy, repugnant mess. They were building their gods. I do. I am. It's me. That's what they were doing. And Yah says that you have no power in that arena. It doesn't produce nothing at all. You're miserable. You're full of sin. That's why God is not worth a damn dollar, not one of them. You can buy them all for a penny. Produce nothing at all. No life, no health, no creative power. None whatsoever. There's none like Yah. There's none. That's what we must remember, the old things. And what caused them such devastation of death and segregation from Yah. And the enemy keep our minds from that. That we don't revisit our forefathers and those that come up through great agony. We don't remember that, Yisrael. And so we don't understand the power of Yah. We don't visit that. Our minds are not taken by captivity to those activities of our forefathers. So what do we do now? We allow the enemy to train our minds through subtleties, through his mirama, his treachery of deceit, to make us think we have something, we have nothing, to make us think that we look fine and we're not fine, to make us think that we're doing well, we're not doing well. And that is what he has done. He doesn't share his beauty with no other. Damn every God. He's not going to allow them to have preeminence over him. He's not going to allow us to have that. That's why he said, I'm the head of Yahshua. My word, I am the authority. It is of my Rosh. That is where my Torah come from. At first they denied that. It is a damnable, wicked shame. And we've been taught by this religious whore to deny it. Forget HaShabbat. Keep Yom Rishon the first day. Do what you want to. You're free. We're not free. You're bound to sin. We're bound to the bondage of sin. When Yahshua makes us free, we're free. Yah is the head of his Rush. Yahshua is the head of man. And a man has the testimony of Yahshua, not this thing we call men that walk like a man, that has the similitude of a man. That's not a man. He has the testimony of the power of Yah. Yahshua is his light. He has the revelation of Almighty Yahweh. He does the works of Yah because he believes on Yahshua HaMashiach. He has the power of Yahshua HaMashiach. He said, the things that I do, greater things shall you do also. And greater things that we walk in perfection of Torah. We damn every God. We assault every God. We come against them with the vengeance of Almighty Yah. We must destroy them. We cannot pacify the wicked. Well, God is good to me. What God? Your Baptist God? Your Methodist God? Your Methodist God doesn't give a damn about the Baptist God. And certainly your damn Pentecostal God doesn't give a damn about the Lutheran God. And your damn Lutheran God doesn't give a damn about the Protestant God or the Anglican God. And that is the truth. I don't care where you go, you have God worship. Tens of millions of forms of God worship. 6.6 billion, you got 6.6 million gods. And you have gods vying for that individual as well. Hashatan took a third with him to pursue his damnable assault against Yah. And everything we have learned from the damn wicked gods have been an assault against his Torah. Everything. That's why he said, you shall rise up in an army of my soldiers as gods. And we shall assault this one. We shall build our tower unto the heavens, our high-mindedness and our state of our pride and our arrogance. And we're falling into every kind of damn wickedness and sin that is imaginable to the mind. We create sin. We create wickedness. We create things that are so vile and repugnant before Yah. It is then an army is what he is trying to create. He took with him a third. When he saw the beauty of the simple form, he says, simple and foolish. If the mind is removed from Yah, HaShatan did not abide in truth, did he? In the Torah, did he not? He did not abide there. And so what he did with Shavha, he kept a mind from abiding in the Torah of Yah. And that's what every God does. It keeps us from abiding in Torah. It keeps us from thinking on Torah. It keeps us away from Torah. Keeps Torah absent from our mind to where we forget it. And then when we forget it, we forget to teach our children. And when we forget to teach our children, they began to create and produce even more gods. And they open themselves up to gods as Yisra'iyah. Even their forefathers did not even go after those gods. So he said, I'm telling you this, that your idolatry and your worship of idols, it's not producing a damn thing. There is none like me. There are gods of gold and silver, stubble, wood, clay. Laban, when he followed Yaakov, he had many gods. Who has stolen my gods? If your God can be stolen, he's not worth a damn. Damn your God. Abraham's avatar had many gods. When our minds are turned away from the Torah of Yah, from his mitzvah, these 10 instructions is where life resonates from. Upon the power of that is a Torah of life. From the power of that, we see the embodiment of that in Yahshua HaMashiach. So the God's not worth a damn, Yisra'iyah. And I am not going to stop saying that. Damn them all. Damn their Christo. Damn your Jesus. Damn him. Because your Jesus is a corrupt damn myth and a lie created in a damnable corrupt mind because I see the image of your Jesus. It's not Yahshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. 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 There is none of the power of Almighty Yah, and none of his strength, his tenacity. It began in the Bereshit of all things, when the Ishah did not keep her mind busy on the things of the Torah. The enemy keeps us today as busybodies, everybody's affairs, everybody's activities. We're nosy. We talk too damn much. We love to chatter. We open ourselves up to the powers of darkness. And so when Hava was not about the instructions of her Ish, the man, she found herself wandering. And that's what we do. We wander away. We wander away from Torah. Our minds are captivated by folly, all kind of silly, simple stuff. It's almost like a child in a store. They run and don't take them to where the toys are. Everything they see, they want. They're touching, they're grabbing, they want everything. That's the way we are. That's the way our minds are. They are so polluted, so convoluted. We will not choose the right thing. We choose everything that is evil and wrong to do. She had the Torah of Yah, the words whereby choose all of this, but that you don't choose. Yah says, choose me, you have life, shalom, you have the riches of my creation. You choose that, you have nothing but death, separation from me, and your mind will never be appeased with anything. When a man is not appeased with a billion, he got to have 2, 3, 4, 5. You know something is twisted in that damn wicked mind. When a wicked nation like this nation says we got to have a minimum wage, then hell, why not have a maximum wage as well? You see the damn corruption? It's wicked. If there's minimum, you're going to pay me $7.25 an hour. That's not even a poverty wage, Yisrayah. Then there should be a maximum wage, no more than $2 million. Sure, it should be. But that's not the way the God of this world operates. It is to squeeze out, to break, to destroy. That everyone is brought under his delusion that when he speaks, when he began to manifest himself as a mighty one, then we will trust him. That's why we have been destroyed, because we don't have the knowledge of his acts and his deeds. We must be aware of this wicked one of hell, his subtlety. It begins here in the book of Bereshit, Genesis. Hallelujah. I'm going to work through this today, Yah's will. The book of Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. I want to read this carefully. It says, now the Nahash, the serpent, the beast. Now the Nahash, it says that he was more arum. He was more subtle. He was very crafty. He was shrewd. His words were very alluring. He had the power to bring about a delusion just with his words that he speak. I give us an example of those that they call motivators, that they bring crowds of people and they motivate them to be rich. Men like T.D. Jakes, men like Benny Hinn, they have no power of healing. It's all a delusion of the mind. There's not one organic healing in the midst of their damned gods. Their damnable Benny Hinn's God is named Benny Hinn. How do I know it is Benny Hinn? Can I tell you how I know it is, and the name of that God is Benny Hinn? Because it is Benny Hinn's ministry. I know that the God is Creflo Dollar because Creflo Dollar's ministry. I know that the God, it is not even the damn Christo ministry. It's not even the ministry of their Jesus Christ. I know that all robbers was a damn serpent of hell raised up by the powers that be, because it was all robbers' ministry. I know that. You don't have to tell me. I know they're damn gods. And we see the results and the frailty of the damn wicked gods at the end of their lives, because no one can substantiate what they have done, and that God does not give favor to no one else. How do I know that it was a Billy Graham God? That was his name, Billy Graham. He was of no substance because he was a Graham. A Graham is a small thing. The old man, I don't make mockery of the old man dying, but he's dying. And so Richard Roberts his son tries to incorporate that, but it's not like it was when he was there, because the God gives no favor. The gods, they don't give a damn. They don't give a damn. They are venting for one thing. We rise up with an army, and they get frustrated with man because of his impotent, immature ways, because he is just a temporal damn thing. That's what frustrates the gods. That is what frustrates the gods. I'll never forget, Evangelist Hartsfield said to me 30-some years ago, he looks at me, he said, "You know what, Brother Roberts? It is one thing that the powers that be the enemy, it is so difficult for them to get things in the mind of man. They must constantly, you know, change and alter to get that one little concept into his mind. Isn't it difficult for y'all to get truth in us? It is difficult, isn't it?" So I know the name of their gods. It is the T.D. Jakes ministry. Oh, he has the Potter House there. The Potter House, the whole house, is to shape them under the image of T.D. Jakes. Do you understand? That's what the Potter House is for. But the power of his wealth comes from T.D. Jakes' ministry. So that's the God, Jake. What is the damn Jake? That's why y'all gave his house names that reflects his power. And the gods have given us names to reflect his damn twisted ways. And we sometimes get a little eerie by even calling one another a name that is away from the damn name. No, I don't call her. I call her Raphael. You understand? And so what we do, we try to perpetuate the God power and the statehood of the gods. I will prove that out as I go, Father. You don't have to love me. That's all right. Hallelujah. Now the Nahash, the serpent, was more Arum. He was wise, he was prudent, more cunning than any beast or high life, anything in the garden, in the fields, which Yah had made. And he said to the woman, "Has Yah said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Yah said, of every tree you can eat, except." But he just took the first part. "Has Yah said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Yah says, of every tree of my creation you may eat, except the tree of the da'at, the knowledge of tov and evil." Because Yah would have brought Adam to that state and said, this is the reminder of that damn Nahash, that beast of hell, that rose up against me. I created you, that you from your loins, from dust of the earth, shall bring forth a shalah, a praise, an offering unto me, whereby nothing could match it, to show this beast. And this shall be to be a reminder of this vile thing that rose up and thinking that he can compete against me, thinking that he can reduce me, he's going to rise above my throne. See, that's what this mind does. That's what when this Nahash, this beastly nature rises in us, we rise up above the laws of Yah. Our minds rise up above the Torah of Yah. We begin to declare what is right and wrong. We become antsy with him. We become antsy with those that tell us the truth. We defy it, Yisrayah. And that's what that serpent did. He rose up. It is that wickedness, his own indignation, say, "I will rise up, I will establish my throne in the side of the north, in the mountain, the hair of Yah. I will become like him." And Yah says, "You damn beast of hell, you shall be brought down to the earth. And when men see you, I will preach that one day, they will look upon you and say, is this the man that really caused the kingdoms of the earth to shake? And cause the people to be brought subject unto this little damn dirty beast?" That is what that Nahash does. That is why he was a serpent. And that is what the serpent in us does. The serpent always raises his head, doesn't it? And that's what we do. We raise up our rush to strike against Yah. That's the power of our God power. That's the power of our Godship. That's the power of our Godship. We cannot create nothing. You cannot even create one little damn drop of dirt. Nothing! You can create one flower petal. So the day you defy Yah, did he not say, did not Yah say, you shall not eat of every tree? Yeah, he told of all the trees you eat except that one. And she began to ponder that he knew once he said it, that it allowed the spirit of the serpent to enter in. That is the power of the Loshon language. It opens up our minds for the power of darkness to enter in. That's why you're giving your children, your babies to the world. To train them. Yah commands you to train your children. To bring them up. I'm going to teach on that soon. He commands you in what? In the way of Torah. You train them right, they will never depart. They will never depart. Yah is not a liar. He cannot lie. When she allowed the Lashon, the language of Hashatan, she began to tentatively listen to him. And then she went beyond the Torah of Yah. Have you ever said, I know I have said, well, I don't see what's wrong with that. We've all said that. Well, I know what Preacher David said, but I don't see what's wrong with it. I know you don't. I don't see no harm in it. I know that's what she said. I don't see why, no reason why we should not. So we justify what is even wicked, even though you know it's wicked, you still justify it. You know it's wrong. We that know to do tav and do it not, it's a sin. And the Torah is tav. The way of Yah is a tough way. You can't go wrong that way. We must obey. We cannot defy. And that's what he injected into our mind to defy Yah. And so when we began, our gods need an offering. We need someone to bow unto our statements, our will. We seek out gods of the same order of business. And they speak the words to us to keep us captivated and bound by the rituals of hell, that we pay homage. Oh, you don't go out and put a bread offering out, but you give them a bread offering. You give your heart to them. You give your will, your mind. Oh, you don't go out and build your little God. It's already built. You have a tower. It is your exalted self above Yah. We exalt ourselves. We esteem ourselves more highly than others. And above all, we esteem ourselves more highly than we esteem Yah. So we lift ourselves up on a pedestal. We become grandized and we promote us. We don't promote Yah. And that's what he put in her mind. To promote yourself. Listen here what he says in verse 5. Hallelujah. He says in verse 5. He says, Yahweh does yada. He must confess. And even to Dawid, he says, is it not that you are gods? In that expression, or Elohim, that's why the word Elohim is plural. It is not singular. It can be used in the singular sense, but it's plural. He says, for Yah does yada. He must acknowledge. He must confess that in the day that you eat thereof, then your ayin, the spring or the fountain of your mental and spiritual ability, that's what we use today, don't we? We use our own predilection of our own mental faculties to discern what is right and wrong, don't we? It is not the internal power of the Torah to show us what is proper before Yah, that we will know what is absolutely accepted by him. We don't know that today, Yisrael. We don't understand that. We have no perception of that at all. In the day that you eat, Bereshit Genesis 3 and 5, in the day that you defy Yah, your eyes shall be opened. Your eyes shall be pochad, and you shall be as gods. And this is the only criteria of a God, knowing what is tavin ra. He didn't say you can create your own world. You can create your own substance. You can produce beside Yah. He said the day that you defy Yah, then you will become gods. I know what Yah says. I'll read that. You'll become a god. The day that you determine of your own self-assurance, of your own knowledge, then you will become a god. If you want to accept evil, you can. We accept evil. We accept things that are wrong and wicked before Yah, because we are gods. We have the power to choose and to elect what is right for us. And what is for them, it may be wrong, but it's right. I don't care how repugnant, how wicked it is. What he's doing his thing, I'm doing my thing. It makes no difference at all. They're all right in their own eyesight, in their own ways. I don't care how wicked they are, you still justify. And we make them right. That's wrong, Yisrayah. It is not of Yah. It is the power of the gods. And a god is not like Yah. Damn all the gods. Let them all be damned. Let the god of our belly be damned. Let it be brought down to the gates of hell, Yisrayah. Let it be brought down. It says in verse 6, and when the woman saw that the eret, or the tree, was tough for food, hallelujah, and that it was pleasant, it was pleasant, desirable, it was a nice thing to have, to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat. And she gave it to her husband also with her, and he did eat. When the woman saw that from her own perception, it was created by the Loshon of Hashatan. You must understand, he did not abide in Torah. He did not walk in the disciplines of Yah. And when one speaks to us that are not walking in the Torah of Yah, they open our eyes up to everything that is seductive and wicked before Almighty Yah, to be Torah transgressor, because the purpose of it all is to build a contingency to fight against Yah. Isn't that what Nimrod, 675,000, that they were going to go into the heavens and make war against Yah? Did they not shoot their arrows into the heavens to make war against Yah? Isn't that what the technology is all about today, their Mars exploration and all that? And I'll bring that out, if not the day, next week. I know I can finish this all in one day. But isn't that what that's all about, to find the gods and the powers of the gods? This is just not something coincidental what this nation is doing. There's a God in this nation, and y'all is not a damn God. He is not. We're going to see the performance of that on tomorrow, what they call 9/11, a nation that butcher and kills, destroys, have butchered over 1 million people, because they said 3,000 people were destroyed on the 9/11. And yet they have butchered babies and killed and destroyed. And yet they celebrate their own little small, not that the lies were small, I don't mock that, but in the scheme of what they have done, from this damn wicked nation, from this damn mind, I'm not going to stop saying it, the white mind, every nation it goes into, it destroys, it breaks, it pillages, it takes, it robs, and it kills. It brings diseases and death and devastation upon the land. Let's be honest. Let's just be honest. Don't protect no damn white skin or black skin. Let's defend Yeshua HaMashiach. Let's defend the word of Yah. That's what we are set to defend, the Torah of Almighty Yah. And yet, because 3,000 people were lost, they snuffed out tens of thousands of people. They killed, they dropped their bombs in the midst of darkness, the cowardly, bastardly acts upon the homes of babies and mothers that had nothing to do with anything, that were trying to eke out a living. I don't give a damn if they were Muslims or Hindus, it makes no difference, or Christian. And the only thing that gives me a sense of appreciation, I know that the hook is in the jaw of this eagle. This is Yah. There's nothing that is being done without the consent and the control that he turned the hearts of these evil men. Why? That when he pour out his wrath upon this whore, even the remnant will not even question him. They will say, certainly we should have received even more. We cannot even question Yah, his acts, his deeds. We cannot. And that's the only thing that gives me some kind of resolution of comfort. I know that this is in the hand of Yah. This was not how Shaitan did that. It was Yah. It was not the devil that caused those planes to fly into the power of her strength, a capitalist system, and a power of democracy. She tries to spread her capitalist power, the god of capitalism, and the god of democracy to every corner of the world. She doesn't give a damn. And her capitalist power destroys and rent nations down to puppets and dogs, and a democracy destroy the people. Turn the women away from disciplines, and the sons and the daughters, and every kind of wicked thing, every door is open, pornography and sin, faggism, and men turning into women and women turning to men, every kind of damn wicked thing. This is the power of the gods. This is the power of the strength of the gods. To formulate an army to denounce Yah, to formulate an army to come against Yah, to formulate an army to rise up against Yah, thinking that it is able to understand his ram, and they cannot do it. They will not get a spaceship out to the outer realms of what we call the earth, and all of our lifetimes combined, and all of the lifetimes of the earth combined here. He's so wide you can't get around him. So high you can't reach to the height of his zenith. They can send them out, refuel them by the stars, but that's all right. He has a little meteor rod that say destroy it. And just they will never be able to understand the depths of Yah. You don't find this out by some kind of sending out discovery. Discovering what? You can't discover Yah that way. He must discover you. He discovered us, you understand? You may discover your gods to give you strength, but you will not discover Yah that way. You're not going to find him out there in the outer space. You will find the gods out there. You're not going to find him on Mars. You will find your god there, the god Mars there, Hermes, but you will not find Yah there. You won't find him there. Not at all. Period. And so the whole contingent plan of HaShatan, he said, I will try to integrate my concept in the mind of man through birth, through production, because I have already got my seed in that woman. And we saw the birth of Cain and Abel. We saw what transpired in that. It shows us the nature of the gods, that he rose up and he slew his brother because his offering was not as pleasing unto Yah as his brother, because his brother Abel offered up that which was just and right and pure in the sight of Almighty Yah. And that's why, listen, Yisrael Shemak, the enemy is doing all he can to keep us from offering up the sacrifices. We got to press beyond ourselves to praise Yah and to offer up Torah unto Yah. We're ashamed to do that. We are so lethargic when it comes to that. Something is wrong in our hearts, Yisrael. We must move beyond this old flesh. I'm telling us that, Yisrael, because it creates hatred for Yah. And that's just the truth, Yisrael. The whole battle is to raise up princes and powers and workers of darkness in the natural realm to do what? To destroy everything that Yah has created, to destroy, to cause misery, to cause the people to be miserable, that they cry out, if you are God, that's what they say. If you're God, why this happened? Oh God, why my baby had to die? Oh God, my mama died. Oh God, this. Oh God, that. Oh God, this. Oh God, damn your God, damn your God. And so this create this infernal madness among the people to rise up against him. And when they see the beauty of Yeshua HaMashiach, they are not coming to celebrate. They will not be there to celebrate, but to bring down and to destroy Yisrael. And that's why the enemy is doing all he can to destroy the Torah, the word of Yah. He's raising up these little effeminate men that are weak and have no power at all. They're weak men. They're shallow. They're weak. They have no substance at all. And that's the truth. To dismantle, to try to destroy. He's raising up an army, a contingency against Almighty Yah. And he says, as he went before Yah, he is an accuser of Yisrael, as he did with Eyob. When the sons, when the creative ones of Yah, their beauty, when they brought the splendor of his excellence before him to bow, it says, then Hashatan came also. And then he asked him, he did not ask him of any man, but have you considered your servant Eyob? Yah asked him, have you considered my servant Eyob? One that Yareh fear me and hates your damn evil input. But there is none like him in the earth. There's not a man like him in the earth. He had beautiful friends, but they were not like him. He had mighty wise men around him, but they were not like him. He said, I want you to consider him. And he said, remove the heads. Just allow the Torah. Just allow the Torah to be questioned in his heart. And he'll curse you to your face, mighty one. Come on. And so when the little hedges are removed around them, oh God, my son, well, he was a damn crack dealer. You sow, you reap corruption. You sow to the flesh, of the flesh, you're going to reap corruption. Oh, my daughter, she was a rebellious Jezebel. You know that. Come on. And so this create this enmity against Yah. And they're calling him God. He is not a damn God. So that's what they do. So when they see the splendor of his coming, they shall come against him mightily. We're going to get him. We're going to get him. And they have no power because there's none like him. He is a man of war now. He knows how to fight. And he fights well. He never lost one battle. He doesn't lose one battle. None whatsoever he doesn't lose. The gods shall come down. They shall come down to the side of the pit of hell. For that is what hell was made for the gods. For the gods. For Hashatan and all of those that pursued his agenda. It is a battle for one thing, the mind, Yisrael. That's why we need Yeshua's mind. You cannot fight against the mind of the gods without the mind of Yeshua. You understand? You must. You have to understand from the beginning. Yah took the woman from the man, and he was her head. He was her rush. And once she got away from her head, she defied Yah. He taught her in the ways of Yah and opened up the wisdom of Yah's Torah. And once she began to move away from that, then she began to do that which defied the covenant of Almighty Yah. We can't do that, Yisrael. And that is the power of the gods to seek out. That's why you're constantly, even in your sleeps, the dreams, hell, there are no dreams from Yah today. You, these folks, I had a dream. Well, it was because you had those pinto beans and sauerkraut and those pork links last night. That's why you dreamed the dream you dreamed. What Yah gives you a dream is profound, the utterance of it. Even to the unlearned ear, they will say, what a profound utterance, that dream is powerful. It's not a dream from Yah. When it's a dream from Yah, it's an impactful dream. Even the ears of the hearers, when they hear it, say, my, we're getting dreams from the gods to substantiate our wicked ways. We are walking wickedly, defying the Torah of Yah. And we think that Yah is talking to us. He said, because you've forgotten me, I've forgotten your children. We are the children of our forefathers. We are the children of our forefathers. And Yah said, because they have forgotten me, he said, I will forget you as well. Because you do not remember the Torah, I won't remember you. The only one that I remember is that boy, the remnant that I said that I will elect and save because of Abraham, his seed Yitzchak, and the promises that came out of Yitzchak and Yaakov. Not even out of you, Abraham, but out of Yitzchak and Yaakov. Hallelujah. Because of you. That is the truth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He goes on to say, when the woman saw that the food, that the tree was good for food, she ate and she wanted to make her husband wise. And the first thing that transpired in verse 7, it says, and the eyes of them both were pokad. I spoke on that word pokad, to be open-minded, to have an open mind, to be gullible, to believe anything. You believe everything, you believe nothing at all. To be gullible, to be over easily, to be overtaken very easily. Their minds, they were open, they were pokad, and they knew that they were arum, they knew that they were naked. And they began to sew fig leaves and they made themselves aprons. Why did they do that? You must understand that the fig tree is YisraYah. It is a representation of the covering. Even there, YisraYah, in that state, the fig tree was represented. And so YisraYah today tried to cover themselves, their own wickedness of their God worship. Among those that say they're YisraYah, they all got different gods. They're still into the damn God thing. They have brought the ways of Misrim, and they brought that into the way of Yah, and they still have the same God worship. They all got their identities. They all got their God thing. And they think because they are the fig tree, they're trying to cover themselves, their sins and their wickedness with the promises of Yah that he has granted unto YisraYah. That's what they are covering. They're trying to cover themselves. And that's what that represents, the covering of the garment that they put on. They took fig leaves and they covered themselves. So that's what YisraYah is doing in the state of all of their God worship. And these damn 41s, they call themselves Hebrews. Call on the name of Jesus and Lord and Baal. They have changed their name. Call on the damn dirty gods. But they change their silly names. They're stupid. They give themselves a name that is Hebraic. They change their name to Abraham, Yitzchak. And yet they call on a damn God, and a damn Baal. There's wickedness in the midst of that house. They don't know Yah, YisraYah. And they try to use the promises of Abraham. And they try to cover themselves with the garment of their unrighteous covering. Oh, the promises are righteous. And the promises are for YisraYah. But they try to use them for a cloak of righteousness. And cover themselves with that cloak. But it's not going to work. That's what Adam did. Tried to cover himself. Tried to clothe himself. But he had already given in to the power of the gods. And you can see from there, there are thousands of scripture that teach and tell us about the God or the proliferation of the gods. And you see with Laban, you see it immediately, how the gods began to proliferate. They had gods for every day. Every day they had a god. They bowed to this god today, the next day that god, next day that god. We do the same thing. We're moody this day. We're angry the next day. We're hard-hearted the next. We're full of our self-righteousness. Talk to me, YisraYah. We're full of lies the next day, full of deceit the next day. And it is not of Yah, YisraYah. This is what Adam tried to do, cover himself with the promises. YisraYah is the fig tree. It must be pruned. And they tried to prune it or to make it correct by covering themselves when they knew that they were arum, they were naked. They were not covered by the promises of Yah. And because of that, out of their loins came death. Out of their loins, and to this day we suffer that death. That's why Yahshua had to go down into the midst of Sheol and take the power of death that will have no sting over the Kedoshim. That we will not have to die in fear and traumatized by death. But death will be the welcome event in our lives. As Shaul says, I long to go and be with him, but I know that it's expedient that he keeps me here for a moment. You all need me, but I tell you, if I had my choice, I would check out today. But I know that for expedience, it is for the best thing that I stay around. Y'all just keep me around for a little while. Hallelujah. And that is the best thing for us, that he keeps Yahshua in our minds, Yisrael. That he keep his word ever present before our mind. And so what happens here is that man tries to cover his sins. We do that excellently, don't we, Yisrael? We try to look for those that are the same covering we have and cloak the way we are and try to cover our sins and cover our wrong. We don't go to Yahshua HaMashiach, but we go to the gods. We look for the damn twisted gods. This is all about a battle. And who is going to win in the end? Yah is going to win by the power of his name. For in that name, he promised that there will be a remnant, a small few that shall not give in to the powers of hell. And the only power we have is the true power of Torah, the Ruach of Yahshua HaMashiach. That's our power. We trust him. He doesn't speak from the heavens every day, but he speaks from the heavens every day. He speaks in the bird tweaking. He speaks in the wind blowing. He speaks in the beauty of a day like this. He speaks to us every single day, Yisrael. He speaks to us. He speaks to us in our lives because he breathed into man. We became living. He breathes into us every morning. We come alive. Where the wicked defy him and kala and speak evil against him, against his name, yet you praise and you exalt the mighty name. Whereby the wicked one raise up the standard of their gods, the Baal, you lift up the standard of Almighty Yah and Yahshua HaMashiach. For there's a great battle that we're in. We're set to defend Yah. He doesn't need it, but he has put us at the forefront of the battle. And everything that Yisrael done, it was to defend his integrity. That's why he said, don't worry about them. The victory is yours. I will give you the victory. Hallelujah. He said, Gideon, send them all home. 300 men, take that. You'll win. Come on, Yisrael. It is not the numerics of a people. It is the heart of the will, what Yah puts in there. It is to denounce the gods, to destroy, to tear down. Hallelujah. You should do more righteous than the generation before you that will give your sons and daughters a righteous heritage. And they will do more righteous than you. And then there will be no more righteous than them. Whereby you have the law of perfection in the mind. And your sons and your daughters and generations. Your name and the power of your character will be substantiated in your sons and your daughters. Here when we find today, dad is a damn drunk and mama's a whore. And they all are wicked as hell. We don't want to deal with that. They're lifting up the standards of their gods, Yisrael. What God? The Baptist God. Damn the Baptist God. The Methodist God. The Pentecostal God. The Church of God in Christ God. They're wicked gods. The Church of God, the Lord, the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ God. We might as well deal with the reality of what state we're in. And the power of the gods that are pressing us every hour, every day. To draw us under this delusion, to make us think that we're greater than Almighty Yah. Because we are a God, then we're greater than Yah. Listen to what it says in the 22nd verse of the same chapter, chapter 3, Bereshit. That this is what Yah says. Genesis 3:22, and Abba Yah said, behold, man, Adam, has become Haya. Now this is what they say is Yah's name. That is what the words Haya, when Yah says, I am that I am. Oh, his name is Haya. You are a jackass, you stupid. What he says, man is Haya. It is a verb that implies he has arisen. He has come to, he has been brought forth. And that's what it means. I have searched the book. Before these juveniles ever knew what the word Hayah was, I knew what the word Hayah. He said, man has become Hayah. Man has become, he has appeared, he exists now. He has become like one of us. What was he implying? What? To yada tov and evil. That's all he became. That's all he knew. He was talking to the host of his creation. In the book of Yasha, it tells us who he was talking to. He said he'd become like one of us. Yah creates tov and evil, doesn't he? Life and death. He tells us to choose life, doesn't he? Did not he do the same thing in the garden? He created life and he created death, didn't he? He created a tree of life and he created a tree of death. That's what he did. And he said, eat from the tree of life and not the tree of death, Yisra'yah. He did the same thing. There's nothing new about Yah. There's nothing new in his creation. It has always been. He created them both. And he said, Adam, eat that. That you don't eat. Why did he do that? To remind him of the power of his sovereignty, his might. Only Yah can. And now he says, man, he has become like one of us. So what he's going to do, he's going to elect and to choose what is right. What is tav, what is ra. There are folks that say that you got these dogs in the whole house. They say to be a faggot dog is all right. To be a butch bulldog or a transgender is all right. Because God is love. I know that your God is love. You don't understand the Ahav of Yah, though. God doesn't judge. I know your damn God doesn't judge, but Yah judge. He makes himself known by the power of his mishpatim. He judges us. He judges everything. He judges our thoughts. The gods don't judge a damn thing. Why? Because it incriminates them and it indicts them. And if they judge, then it incriminates them and show you that they're not worth a damn. And it show you you're worth very little to them. And that's why when you die, they don't give a damn. They don't move one muscle. Just like the Tower of Babel, they say when a brick fell, that the people wept for that. They mourn. But when one fell to the death, they didn't even look. Say, what a damn fool. All the bricks went down. That's what they said, Yisra'yah. That's what they said. They mocked them. They ridiculed them. They laughed at them. He has always set evil before man and tov. He's always set his presence. So he said, now he's become like one of us. Like you, my Melechim. They know the difference between tov and wrath. They will choose what is right in their own sight. What is excellent for them. We do that, don't we? We do that. We choose what is right to us, even though you know it's wrong and wicked. You make it right. Even though you know that it is against the will of Yah, that his Torah speaks against it, we still do that, Yisra'yah. That's all he said, that he become like one of us. Hallelujah. The Melechim, they represented the beauty of Yah. They were his created powers. They were set to defend his heritage. That's why the Melech encamp about the house of them that fear Yah. We don't fear Yah. There is no Melech around us. And when there is no Melech, what are the purpose of the Melech? You know what? They're ministering Ruachim, are they not? They're the ministering spirits of Yah, don't they? They come to minister what the word says. They come to nudge us and remind us what the Torah tells us. They come to nudge us and remind us what Yahshua says unto us, Yisra'yah. And if you don't fear Yah, they're not nudging us. We don't get that much nudging today, do we? We're not reminded of the truth of Yah, Yisra'yah. That's why we go wayward. And we began to go our own way and do our own thing. That's not of Yah. He said, man has Hayah. Well, his name is Hayah. Oh, he's just, what he was saying to Moshe, he said, tell them that I am Hayah. I have come. I've come to tear down the damn gods. I've come to destroy their damn religious infrastructure. That's all he was saying. This is a stupid, stupid generation. I'm a part of that. I'm an ignorant man.
I don't want to be stupid. This is a stupid generation. This is a stupid. That's all he was saying. He said, who should I tell him has sent me? He was saying to him, tell him I have come. I am that I am. Chaya, I am here. I have come to defend my people, to bring them under the yoke of their damn gods, and tell him to let them go. I want him to understand that my power in the bosom of my elect is greater than your damn gods. I'm going to bring your damn gods down. I'm going to break them down. I'm going to destroy your infrastructure. Let them know that higher I am come. Well, who is he that have come? Higher I have come. That's all the word higher means. That's all it means. These damn ignorant individuals, these men that have not the gift of Yah, that are interpreting the Torah of Yah, men that are not elected by Yah, that are not called, that have no time for Yah. How in the hell that a man never spend time with his wife? He's away from his family. The wife is left to raise them. He's trying to make ends meet. How can he instruct a nation in the things of Yah? He cannot. First of all, he has abated his responsibility of his house. He's not even there to protect his children, his wife, if danger comes. That's not a damn man. Even a drunk, even some of the most violent of men will make sure they come home every night. They will do wickedly, but they will come home. It may be late, but they will come home. I'm talking about wicked men. I'm talking about men that don't even know Yah and didn't know Yah. These men say they know Yah. It's a lie from hell. They don't know Yah. Hallelujah. Tell them, he said, that man has Haya. He has become. He has come. He has arisen. He has appeared. And that's what Yah was saying. You tell Pharaoh, I am that I am. Haya, I'm going to appear. I'm going to call the flies, the maggots to multiply. And then when you keep defying me, I'm going to harden your heart because I know that I'm going to break you down. I'm going to call the frogs to die and the stench on the ground. You think they had time to clean that mess up? Maggots everywhere, dead, funky cows and animals ridden the plains, the stench of the nostril of death, sickness and disease. When they began to try to recuperate from that, then the next plague began to come. Can you imagine? You think that there were people there to bury all those firstborns? Death in every house, not one house, only those in Goshen. Death in every house. Who's digging the graves? Death everywhere, bodies rotting here, the stench, flies and maggots and dead frogs. The stench of that, can you imagine that? Yah says, I have come, I have arisen. Dagon, let your damn God be brought down to hell. Tell him, Haya, the one that arises with the sword of power, with might, with strength, that is the one. I am that one. That's why he told him to tell him, I am that I am. Haya, I'm the one that shall arise up. I have risen up. I have entered in. I have made my statement when I said, Moshe, your damn gods are coming down. That is what he was saying. We need wise men today to open up knowledge of Torah. Not these damn grinning dogs and dirty bastards. That's what they are. They don't know Yah. Let me tell you all something, Yisrael. I've watched it. I'm not the oldest one in here, but I've experienced a lot. It is one thing about a deceiver and a liar, and one that speaks one thing and create covenant with one another and turn from them. You can never trust that man or that woman. I don't give a damn who it is. You can never trust them. That's a fact. You'll sure never turn from the ways of Yah. A true friend loves at all time, and a true friend, it's greater to have a friend. A brother's a born adversary, but there's nothing like a friend. You understand? So if I'm unfaithful with you all, I'm going to be unfaithful if I had 10,000 following me. If I intrigue you wrong, if I had 100,000, I would intrigue them wrong too. If I have no care for you that have been faithful and been honorable, you think I will show honor to those that have not shown me one bit? I watch them come here and all of a sudden they find one over here that knows more than this man, and everything he has learned, he learned from him. He didn't learn a damn thing. That's why he never progressed and matured. And so when he went forth in his ventures, he was easily manipulated and everything about him was altered. Hallelujah. Why would not they come challenge me? Because they're afraid. They can hide behind telephones and letters and emails. I will. Maybe those are the ones that are falling off my enemies when I talk like that. Hallelujah. Getting back to the point here. Hallelujah. He said, they become like one of us to know yada tov and evil. He said, now this is what I must do. He said, now, lease or peradventure, he put forth his hand and take forth the tree of life and eat. He shall live olam viat. He shall live forever. He said, I must put him out. I got to put him out. And once I do that, I know what's going to happen. He knew what was going to happen. The power of the God mind, you will see the flourishing of that. And we see that today. And anytime we put the Torah out of our hearts, anytime we put the testimony of the tree of life, we see the power of the God mind flourishing in us. We love the gods. We love to interact with the gods. We proceed after the gods. And that's the truth. And we think we have life or we have substance in us. And Yah said, put him out. Put them out. And he put him in lockdown with the sword, the living power of Torah. That they can never enter. Man can seek all he wants to. He will never find that place. Or he can find the region of the earth that it was once located. But he will never find that place. It's beyond the mental ability to see that. This was something done by the hand of Yah. Do you see the air? You don't see the air, do you? There's oxygen. There's H2O. There's water and oxygen in this building. That's why our lungs are breathing, to keep it moist. You don't see that, but we are alive. You don't see light, but we have the high. We are like living vegetation and animals. We have light. We have something. We have strength in us. Yah said, put him out. Drive him out. Because if I don't drive him out, if I don't thrust him out, he's going to eat. And that's why Yah driving these children of the gods, the God of this earth, Hashatan, he's driving them out. He's driving them to their God and their gods. He's driving them to their habits and their ways. They dress like whores. They act like faggots. They have no strength.
That's the truth. I said to my Yeshua this morning, I say one thing that I never complained about all the years I've been married to her. I've never complained about her hair. Never. Just, I like it plaited. Just keep it that way for me. Your beauty, it accentuates your beauty more than anything. I've never complained about that. Never. I don't want her looking like the world. You see how the world got your daughters at this time so messed up? You don't even understand beauty. That's the truth. I give a damn if you get upset. Y'all don't even understand beauty. It's the image of the world. Hallelujah. I said, never complain about it. Never. Never. Fix your hair. No, that's pretty to me. Just leave it like that. Just plaits. It's all right, baby. I like it. It's soft. It's beautiful. You see how the world has messed our minds up? As I said, words, the power of words, the loshon, language, create the images. That's what the gods do. Create images and false delusions. And we don't even understand the beauty of Yah. We don't understand that. Put him out. Throw him out. Because if he become partakers of this, he will live forever.
And he will, I will just have to just destroy him, annihilate him. But I want to give him the chance that he prove himself that he's a God. You gods challenge me. You're going to die. Isn't that amazing that gods die and lords die? The most powerful drug lords, they die. I'm not going to get into that to definitive on this week. I'm going to close out next week with that one, all right? I want to show us some things. The word God, you should never use it in our vernacular to express the Most High. Baal, Jesus, deity, divinity, any of that kind of damn twisted mess. It's wrong. And we have to guard our tongue. We have to govern ourselves that we may speak the right things that Yah wants us to speak. Yisraya. Hallelujah. I want to read a few more verses. I'm going to close a little early today, all right? Hallelujah. I want to read this in the book of Yeshaya, Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 48, verse 11. This is for you, Yisrayam. Yah says, he says this, Yisrayam. Even as the many trials that we shall endure and the tribulations, truly, it is about one thing. Although we shall suffer greatly, the heavens are going to be open, are they not? And every God there is coming down to establish an army against Yah. I know that sounds crazy. It sounds something of mythology. We've been taught that. We've been trained. Our minds have been taught that. And they shall come down. He's going to pull the covers from the heavens. And every demonic power there is, the powers, principalities, the rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness in high places, these gods, they're coming down as they did when they first left Hashemaam. They intermingle with man and they produce babies in the beautiful women of Tizayon, the daughters that Yah had created. They took upon them wives and they produced sons and men that were renowned, powerful men. Not these little twisted faggots, the Greek gods, the Hercules, but these were mighty men of strength. They were valiant men, men like Goliath, 7-8 feet tall, 300 pounds, 400, massive men of strong that could rip a tree out of the ground. Powerful men. And this is what it's all about. To reconstitute their allegiance unto Hashatan. To establish a kingdom of darkness. To defy Yah's kingdom. There is no light in the kingdom of Hashatan. There is no rule of life in that kingdom. It is only in the kingdom of Yah where we have the rule of life. There's no life in darkness. You can grow one damn fig in a doghouse. You can grow one plant. You need a lighthouse. Need light in. I don't care what you do, you can't grow it. And the fruit of Yah in your shoe cannot grow from our lives. If we are impeded by the powers of the gods and our minds are darkened by the state of the power of their words to seduce us and to draw us away from Yah. We cannot get there, Yisrael. Period. It says in the book of Yeshua, Isaiah 48, verse 11, he says, Yah says, for my ma'an, for my sake, for my purpose and my intent, even for my own sake, will I do it. For how should my name be polluted? How shall my name be so desecrated and defiled? Yah says, I will not give my kabod. Listen, he said, I'm not going to give my honor and my splendor to another. He is not going to give his honor to no damn God. He doesn't give his kabod, his honor, his splendor to no one. So that's why even tribulation is a process of cleansing to rid our minds of the God power, because we have become a nation, a legion of gods. And we seek out the gods. And if you study the mythology of the Greeks and the Romans, you will see the union of gods to produce. And I will get into that next week. And I promise you, this is the last week on this, as far as this is concerned, all right? We are destroyed because we lack, we believe, we don't have knowledge of truth. If I do the footwork, then you just sit and eat, all right? If I go out and plow the garden, plant, and harvest the fruit, it's you should be able to cook it and prepare a meal that you can eat from. So I don't mind doing the labor. I don't mind doing the physical or the spiritual labor, because I want to prepare you, and your mind may be prepared that you understand the assault of the enemy against Yah, his name. Yah says, I will not give my beauty to no one. I want to read that again. He said, and I will not give my honor, my kabod, and I will not give my splendor to to another, to one that is strange, and all gods are strange to Yah. He said, I will not give that. I will not give my beauty. I will not give the essence of my name. I will not give my name to associate with these damn wicked gods and the Baals. I will not do that. We would be surprised when we began to look at the word God, how it derived to its states through the morphing of this word. You will never use it. You will not even address that in any way to associate Almighty Yah with. And it is appalling to see the ignorance of the people, that they tell everyone, let no one tell you anything, and they're ignorant. And the enemy is so wickedly, ignorantly ignorant, that you can search out his ways. In order for you to understand anything, you just study the matter. That's all you got to do. Isn't this what they call the informational age? There's nothing that is hidden. If you go out here in the street and sit down the drop, 50 people pass by, everybody got out a cell phone. Everybody got out a cell phone. They can record that, everybody. That is the truth. Everybody got a cell phone. They record. Look at this. Everybody recording. I don't even know how to use those things. Not that I cannot use it. I don't use it. Not me. Everybody got a clip to the hip today. Stupid. I hide mine. That's right. I don't want no one to know I got one. Hallelujah. Yah says, I will not give my splendor to another, to a stranger. To those, I will not do that. But he also says in the 42nd chapter, verse 8 of Yeshayah, this is beautiful here. I'm going to close here today. Hallelujah. I know you that are listening there, I know my Achmikaya. That's all right. We're feeding the bread today, and we'll return on next Shabbat. This is the blessing for Yisrayah and his kingdom. This is our assurance on this day. Isaiah 42, verse 8. He says, I am Yahweh, I am Almighty Yah, that is my name. That's what he said. I know what it says in the KJV and all these renditions. I am the Lord thy God, that is my name. That is not a damn name, that's a title. Big Mac Daddy is a drug lord, but his name is Big Mac Daddy. He's a drug lord. He controls a region and a sphere. And you don't come in Big Daddy Mac's playground and try to do anything, because he will kill you. Fact of the matter. He says to us that I am Almighty Yahweh. I am Yah. That is my name. That is Hashem. That is my name. He says, and I want you to know this, my kabod, my honor, and my splendor to... I will not give it to another. Nobody can share in that. So how could a damn God be the mighty one, the creator? He said, I won't give it to another. And then he tells us this. He said, neither my tehillah, my praises, my adoration, and my thanksgiving to graven images. We have created images in our minds. Whether it's our sons, our daughters, our relatives, our kinsmen, our homes, our things, our jobs. There are folks that are more excited about going to work than they are to lift up Yah. They're more excited about hanging with the boys than they are with their ish or their ish, or hanging with the women. They're more excited about that. They're more excited about being out instead of being home. I'm excited about being home. I love being home. You like being away. I like being home. That's just me. I just like being at home. Hell, what's out there but the contentions of the gods? What's out there? Tell me. There's nothing out there. sin and wickedness. He said, I will not share my beauty with anyone. So damn the Lord God, damn Baal, damn them all. These damn fools out here. He is higher. He has arisen in us. He has come in. He has appeared unto us in Yeshua HaMashiach. So you go down and tell Pharaoh that I am that I am. I challenge these dogs to take time. I can show them 500 scriptures. I have at least 300 or 400 that deals with the word Haya. All right. Let them challenge me. Let's sit down. You all that listen, you got someone, tell them, here I am. All right. All right. Hallelujah. Yeah. He knows his name. He knows the name of his people, Yisrael. We're the elect. I know I say it that way. Even when we say Israel, we don't even say it right because we're saying it with an E-L. With an E-L, it should be with an A-E-L. A-A-L-E-L. L. So don't try that with me, all right? I'm a student. I am a student of words. And so Yisrael, we identify that we are the people that overcome by Yah. It's difficult for us to say that, isn't it? Yisrael. What's so difficult about it? Because we are people that we're set in our own ways, and our ways seem right, and we defy Yah. It shows the significant. One writes me and says, Reach, I don't see the way you enunciate that, my friend. It is just simply identifying the power of our prevailing. When Yah says, your name will not be called Yaakov anymore, it shall be called Yisrael, for thou hast prevailed. And it is by the power of Yah that we're going to prevail against the gods. Yeah. We're going to prevail against the Baal. So we have prevailed. That's all that means. That's why I say it that way. That we incorporate his identity into every name, our name, our children's name, our son's name, our daughter names, our businesses, our buildings. Come on. That's what every name, even when those that, even those that children that rebel, Yah gave them names to show the spirit and the seed of what was in that child and what it would produce. That's what he did. And so the gods of this nation, the God of this nation has created with the people of the diasporas a name system that gives us, associates us with same of the same, shall be of the same slavery and the mentality of those that were before us. And that's why we're so reluctant. I'm not reluctant. Damn, David. I like Dawid. I like Dawid Yisrael. Who is the Roberts? A damn robber. That's all it is. They robbed my family tree. Hell, I don't even know where it began unless I look back at Abraham. That's what they did. They robbed my tree. A horn. What in the hell is a horn? You're blowing something? A McClinton. A massive, just a massive damn mess. We might as well get real. Sinji, what the hell is that? We are sick people. Chapman. You're a man, huh? You come from the chap and a man. What is a chap in British? Silly little boy, come here, chap. We defend a corrupt mind. We're afraid to assault it. I'm not afraid to assault the mind of the God, all right, of this damn wicked nation. Hallelujah. I'm not afraid. You may be. I am not afraid. And I will not be afraid, Yisrael. And I will not apologize. His people, everything we do, all of our action represents him. Our babies represent the authority of the bosom of the Avant. It represents his kingdom power. Come on. At least those of the diasporas, they did begin to create names that identify with Shanakamakas, whatever it was, Rashanda Rakuka. Didn't have meanings to it, but at least it was some form of breaking the lineage of that identity. And so at least they did try something. That is the truth. We must go back. We must go back to the pure language. I wanted you to teach on that, but I'll teach on that at some time from the book of Zephaniah, that he's going to return to a pure people with a pure language. There's only one pure language where every word is the same. No interjecting, every word is the same. To. What to? T-O? Which preposition? T-O? T-O-O? Which noun? Which verb? T-W-O? What are we talking about? A language that's twisted. A language that is riddled with every kind of pagan symbolism, symbology. I know it for a fact because I study it all the time. I listen to the words and the speech of men and what people say. And I have watched men with the subtlety of darkness deceive the minds of people. I tell you this story before I close. There was a young man. He's about 50 years old now. His name was Micah Brown. Back in the days, he was a con man. Micah Brown would travel the eastern seaboard, California. He played con games. His whole family was that way. All his sisters were prostitutes. All of his brothers were hustlers. All of them. Every last one of them were hustlers. They hustled, stole, played con games, gambled. But he was a con man. He was slick. He could literally talk people out of their shoes. And they believed him. The way he presented himself. He said to me one day, because it was a challenge to him, it was an expensive store in South Park. He said, that's the only store I have not been able to steal something out of. I've hit them all, whether it's Belk, Ivy's, Montando's. There's easy cake there. He said, but I know what I'm going to do to get them. He said, I'm going to get them because they think they're slick. He said, what I'm going to do one day, David, he said, I'm walking in the place. He's a young little cat. He said, I'm going to buy me some of those round-rimmed glasses. They look like glasses. He said, and I'm going to put on a sweater and a preppy shirt. He said, I'm going to get them watch. He said, I'm quite sure he got them. But he could talk to people with his words, and they were seduced. They would trust him with tens of thousands of dollars. This cat would come back with thousands of dollars just talking and playing con games on people. And that's what the world has done. It has conned us with this damn thing of the God power. It has conned us all that we think we're right, we're self-righteous, and we have all lifted up our towers of idols above Yah, and now we are in the assault mode against him. Well, I don't believe that. He's not right. No, Yah's right every time. Shaul was not wrong. Can you show me one place where he was wrong? Please show me that. Show me where he was wrong. In every letter he wrote, he was right. Did they have the knowledge of Torah like him? No, they did not. Can every man build the way one man builds? No. Does every man have the skills he have? No. Can every man learn from him? Yes. Is everyone here an electrician? No. Can everyone drive a big man? I wouldn't even drive the vehicle he drive. I would be too scared. I don't even want to drive it. Can you climb the trees like this, Akia? No, you get up there, you get scared. I don't like getting up on buildings. I don't even like getting up on, I'm just telling you. I'm very careful when I get up high. I said, Doc Simeon, we're going to paint the two-story roof. And I said, what we do, we were talking. I said, man, what we do now? When you paint this side here, well, all you're going to drop is on the deck, but that's all right. We're going to have a rope and a belt around you on this side. On that side. So you just paint that side. Don't go no farther. If you fall, we got you. You understand? He said, I'll tell you what would be the best thing. We just put a belt on each side. So when I go there, if I fall one way or the other, wise move. I like both of those. Hallelujah. So you can't do, everyone cannot do. Can every sister cook like every sister? No, there are things that one ahot can do that the other ahot cannot cook. Sure, that's why the body can your toes do what your fingers do? No, they cannot do it. And your foot do what your hand does? No. Every part is important. We need every part. May Yah barak you all. You that have joined us, we're going to stop here today. May Yah strengthen you all. May enrich you, Yisrael. Many may betray, but there will be those that will stand. Many will turn away. There will be those that will stand. Let us stand to our feet. Hallelujah, as we turn toward Yerushalayim. In all things we do barak you, Ara Abba, for your kindness, your mercy. You have been tough to us this day. Touch us all and guide us. Strengthen us in your Yeshua's name. We ask you to fill us with your power of your Ruach, with great guidance as we leave this place today. Give us rest on this Shabbat, the Shabbaton, and preserve us all and keep us in the way, the derech of life in Yeshua. We pray for your people scattered abroad. We barak you for all things. And we rejoice in all of the abundance of your riches in Yeshua. We ask that you look on your people and Yisrael and every nation and every place. We ask it all in Yeshua's name. And with our voices, we cry, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. 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 Yabarak Yisrael.